Good morning. Let's take a gospel approach to our worship to begin with. Is that all right? But you know, that requires, if you're willing and able to, that requires a little bit of standing up. So let's sing this together, nice and strong. Here we go.
Fall.
Man, it's just good sometimes to make those anthems of declaration, isn't it? I mean, just to stand up and declare how great he is, and to stand up and just declare that we are buried with Christ, raised to life forevermore. My name has been carved upon his heart. Your name has been carved upon his heart. Not death, not hell could ever separate us. We can declare it, we can sing it, we can believe it because it's true. But there's also the reality that despite its truth, you know, we're not exempt, are we, from dying, from hardship or from loss. And I'm not ignorant enough to know that some of you out there, and maybe some of you tuning in, were listening to that song, the first two songs that we just sang, it might have sounded a little bit like a fairy tale to you, because that's not what you're feeling or what you're experiencing in the moment. Maybe life has some hardships for you, some deep, deep questions. And so what you're experiencing is something other than victory or joy or belonging. And you know what? You're normal. You're not a bad person. You're not a failure. God's not disappointed in you. You've not been abandoned by God. You are what they call human. The fact of the matter is that dry bones get everywhere, but so does the breath of God. I would like us to read together this congregational reading. We'll all read the all part together, and then we have the reader parts divided up. Let's read together. Those dry bones get everywhere.
In the workplace and job centers, in the homes and high streets, in the schools and colleges.
Those dry bones get everywhere.
In the shops and sports arenas, in the places of entertainment and the centers of leisure.
Those dry bones get everywhere.
Sprinkling their lifeless dust, sapping energy and draining hope, confusing minds and sowing discontent.
Those dry bones get everywhere.
But so does the breath of God, and so does the hopeful life of the Spirit.
Gentle and powerful, rushing and meandering, transforming radically and little by little, resurrecting, encouraging, stirring, comforting.
Those dry bones get everywhere, but so does the breath of God.
Thank you. Same power that comes. heaven, surely it was through. Since when has impossible ever stopped you? Friday's disappointment, Sunday's empty tomb. Since when has impossible ever stopped you?
That is who you are, the author of life, the author and giver and sustainer of life. Amen. Good morning.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see all of you here this morning. And welcome to our friends and family online. Why don't you just turn and wave over there to the cameras? You know, they really do see you waving, and it really means a lot to those folks that are on the live stream. Yes. Can you believe that today is the last day of February? Yes. And why are you clapping? Yes, spring really is right around the corner. But the month of February has been quite interesting, hasn't it, with all the snow that we've gotten? I like snow, but I'm sick of snow. I'm sick of shoveling. But there's a group of people that I want to recognize this morning, and that is our snow team. Yes. They have been quite busy the month of February, some in January, but mostly the month of February. And they come during the day. Some of them have been off work. They come during the day, make sure our parking lot's clear. They come in the night, make sure the parking lot's clear over here so the staff can get in safely. So just a big shout out to any of the snow removal team that is here and anyone that is watching online. Thank you very, very much. Yes. This Wednesday evening, March 3rd, going to be first week of March tomorrow. This Wednesday evening, March 3rd, we are going to be having a virtual prayer meeting online. I just felt the real need to get as many of us who would like to come and join on Zoom Wednesday evening to just pray for our congregation, pray for our community, pray for the needs. Now you might be sitting there thinking, I don't pray out loud. I just pray privately. That's okay. You know, there's power in sitting in silence before God as well. So that'll be this Wednesday night from 6:30 to 7:30. Check your email on Wednesday morning. There'll be an email coming out with the link for Zoom. Also this Wednesday, we have a blood drive here at Hosanna out in our foyer. And if you would like to donate blood, go to our online bulletin and see the directions on there for how to sign up. And next Sunday morning is the first Sunday of March. And we're going to be having Kid Venture here in person on Sunday morning. They will be meeting from 9:30 at the time that we're gathering. And then Kelly Wentz, our children's director, will be also leading the kids in our Zoom at 11:30 Sunday morning. And I think with that, I'm all done. And I'm going to invite Tony and Joanne to come up and bring us the message.
Good morning, everyone. First, let me say the worship team has been particularly awesome of late.
Yes.
And one of the graces this morning was just grooving with Justin Erb. Wow. Appreciated that, Justin, just the way you were doing the drums there. Anyway, hey, do you see what the title of our message is this morning? Now, how many of you, when you looked at that, just heard in your head the Bee Gees singing those words?
Yes.
In that high falsetto. Somebody want to sing that out for us? You go for it.
No. I'm just mimicking him.
Oh, okay. Well, hang on to that. We'll be there in a moment. I actually wanted to play it was Jeff. You got to do it again now, Jeff.
Oh, no.
I wanted to play a few lines from that for you this morning, but copyright laws won't let us do that live stream and everything, but it's not particularly edifying. It's not a non-edifying song. It's just not particularly, it's not a worship song. But the question is what Joanne was pointing to. What's more famous, the song or the dance moves? Now, when Carol, I got a story to tell you. When Carol and I were new here to Hosanna, before I was on staff, we were just hanging out, we were getting to know people, and we went to a Hosanna Christmas party.
And you came back to church.
There were days when the Hosanna Christmas party was a pretty rowdy thing. And Chris Poggi was providing the entertainment, perhaps his first year to do that, I don't know, but we weren't here before. He didn't know me, I didn't know anybody else, but somehow he called me forward up to the front to illustrate the moves to this song. And this was one of my introductions to Hosanna. Hi, my name is Tony. Watch me dance. I'm a guy who can't walk in a straight line without falling over. Yeah. My fitness coach makes me do that once in a while. Okay, Tony, we just want to test your balance a little bit. Can you walk? I can't walk in a straight line. I would fail a breathalyzer test cold sober. So anyway, Chris called me up to do this. Now, the good thing about it was that I do look like a very young John Travolta. There was nothing about this. This was good. But then Chris kept doing this year after year. Every Christmas party, every time he would do this song, I knew that I was somehow going to get called up and I was going to do Stayin' Alive and do the motions. Guess who has the mic this time? No, I'm not going to do that to Chris. But I wonder if there is, would you want to demonstrate to us?
Chris can come do it.
Any volunteers here who want to just stand in front of the camera and do the...
I saw a video not too long ago where he was doing that dance with his daughter, his now grown daughter.
But John Travolta is like, he's like 88 years old or something like that now. Yeah. That movie was 43 years ago. It's been a long time. Well, what I'm guessing is nobody in here is biting. Somebody at home is standing in their living room in their PJs doing this right now, I bet you. I have done my duty over the years. Well, our tone in bringing you this message is actually far more hopeful than what are the sad lyrics of that song. I mean, it sounds so happy, and they sing it with such, high energy. But here's a couple of the lyrics. Life going nowhere. Somebody help me. Somebody help me. Life going nowhere. Somebody help me. I'm staying alive. That's a testimony of desperation.
Yeah.
I'm hanging on, but just barely. It's not even, for instance, the determination of Gloria Gaynor's, I will survive, I can do that one. that's another song from that same era. That one, gives you energy. Yes, I'm gonna survive too, along with her. But most of us here are not approaching this topic of staying alive with desperation, are we? Or are we? Man, it's been one of those years, right? Mm-hmm. We're a year into this whole pandemic thing. It was a year ago, I guess, this Sunday, that the last time the whole Hosanna congregation gathered together. We never imagined, would we?
Right.
But no, to be honest, spiritually at least, we're not feeling desperate, are we? We're feeling gratitude.
Yep.
Somebody help me? Christ has!
Yes.
Life going nowhere? Well, that was once true of me, dead in my sins, having physical life, but not alive spiritually. But hallelujah, Christ raised me from the dead.
Yeah.
He raised me spiritually, and one day he will even raise me physically. We are living in the good news.
Yes.
And that's the experience we've been talking about here for the last several weeks. This is foundational for everything else we're going to do this year. Picking up on our theme, living resurrection. We had to talk about how we get dead to begin with. And how we stay dead, or why we would. We talked about how we come alive, and today, yes, we couldn't, we had to use this title, how we stay alive in the new life Christ has given us. Mm-hmm. And it's all wonderful. But today's message, we want to give you a caution right up front. Here's where the tone can change again if we're not careful. Because for many Christians, staying alive in Christ sounds like a lot of hard work. And that's because there's been a lot of what Joanne calls bait and switch in how the good news of Christ is sometimes presented. Hey, it's all grace until you trust in Christ for the salvation of your sins. And then once you trust in Christ, grace goes away. And here's the long list of to-dos and to-not-dos that you must obey. And then, wow, and you really got to work at it. And then Christians start sweating, and we start judging each other. It just gets really nasty. And approaching our spiritual lives that way can become a heavy burden. And some of you, probably many of you, are here at Hosanna precisely because you were harmed by that corrupted version of the faith. And you woke up and you said, no, that's not it. If it's gospel, if it's good news, there's got to be good news the whole way through, and not just at the beginning. And then, by the way, that's what the Bible says too. So we're obviously not going to do today's message that way. It's not going to be bam, 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 beat you over the head. This is what you need to do to stay alive. It's good news. To stay alive in Christ is to simply choose. Yes, we must choose. But it's to simply choose to live out what is already true about us. Yeah. How many times have we said that phrase here in the last several years? And you notice that's one of our passions here, because we find that this is probably one of the chief blockages or hindrances to living out a vibrant faith. We don't know what's true about us. We assume things that are not true, and we live as if those things are true, and then we find ourselves stymied and frustrated and disappointed. If we know what's true about us and we can live it out, we can do so with joy and peace and energy. So anyway, let's go back to Colossians 3. We introduced it last week. We introduced this the first phrase of Colossians chapter 3. And there we're going to find some, it's just wonderfully practical chapter, but deeply biblical wisdom on how we can stay alive, perhaps for some of us here to come even more fully alive in the resurrection Christ has given us. So we'll pick it up verse 1. I'll just read the first two verses for the moment. So if you've been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. Okay, to unpack this. It's not that hard to understand. It makes sense, doesn't it? The first phrase, the first line there on the slide is what we did last week. If or so, since you have been raised with Christ, do what? Mm-hmm. Well, the short answer is pursue these things. Mm-hmm. Now, Paul is using two verbs in the Greek here. And we're not going to go into all the Greek here, but one of them means to really want something, mm-hmm. to chase after it, even to the point perhaps of worshiping it. It's what you might do when you fall in love with someone. You know, you pursue. The second verb means to focus your mind on something, to pay attention to it, to ponder it deeply. So we've tried to capture all of that in one English word, pursue, but please hear that it's bigger and better than even all of that. Okay, so Paul says, pursue all of that. What? What do we pursue, desire, worship, focus on, and pay attention to? Resurrection things. Mm-hmm. Christ things. Now, Paul's talking to people in the ancient world who still thought of heaven as up there somewhere. Many people still do. It's okay. So he's speaking of things above. But what he's really talking about is Christ. Christ's kingdom, Christ's desires, Christ's love, Christ's life, instead of the worries and fears and distractions that keep us from having an abundant life. Mm-hmm. Now, he's not saying, and some have suggested this, and we saw some translations that we think really bungled it. He's not saying that life in this world is now meaningless and useless, and the best thing we can do to get is get to heaven as quickly as possible. Right. Yeah. There are people out there who believe that. No, his message was not that we have to get to heaven as fast as we can. Heaven has come to us already. That's what Christ came to do. That's what his message was. So we can be fully alive here and now in this life. We've been preaching this practically every week this year so far, too.
Yeah, on earth as it is in heaven.
Yeah. Be fully alive here and now. And yes, even more fully in the life to come. So it's not life on earth that keeps us from doing that. Life on earth can be all that. It's what we pursue in that life.
Yeah.
It is what we desire, worship, focus on, pay attention to. When Jesus was on earth, he said a very similar thing. He told us, Sermon on the Mount, he told us not to worry. Don't lose sight of the kingdom by continually fretting about stuff. This is a passage I go to from time to time because I'm one of those people that frets about stuff. I love how the message translates this passage in Matthew 6. Has Jesus saying it this way, what I'm trying to do here is to get you to relax. Breathe. To not be so preoccupied with getting so you can respond to God's giving. Mm-hmm. People who don't know God and the way he works fuss over these things. But you know God and how he works. And then here's the key. This is the cool part. So therefore, steep your life in God reality, God initiative, God provisions. Don't worry about missing out. Mm-hmm. You'll find all your everyday concerns will be met.
Yes.
I tell you, I'm not 100% into living into that, but boy, does that sound like good news, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. In other words, what Jesus is saying is pursue these things, Christ things, God things, resurrection things. Steep your life in them. Want them more than anything else. And you know what will happen? Yeah. You'll stay fully alive in your resurrected life. You will.
Yes, and with that good news as just the beginning in the first two verses of this chapter, Paul then goes on to assure us that if we will devote ourselves to seeking Christ things and Christ first, and if we'll want nothing in this world more than a living relationship with him, we can experience right here on earth the fulfillment that we mistakenly thought would have to wait for eternity. You know, God knows that our hearts are fragile. We all know what it's like to want someone to desire us, don't we? We know what it's like to long to have someone seek after us and know us and accept and love us. And we also know, I think, we've all had an experience of what it's like when we think we found a relationship like that, only to be disappointed. Well, Paul was human too. Paul had been hurt like this too. So he is not telling us to pursue Christ, to try yet again to earn love and acceptance. Can't get it from a human? Well, then be worthy enough to receive it from God. That's not what he's saying. He's encouraging us to pursue Christ because he already loves and accepts us. He already knows us and desires us just as we are. We don't have to do anything to earn that. You see, the one that we are pursuing, the one that we're seeking, has always been seeking us. God has always desired. He's always known and loved us so completely that, listen, he did not wait for us to seek him. He came to seek and find us first. And he came in Jesus. And not only did he seek and find you and me, he was willing to die for you and me. In love. That's how much he loves us. And he was willing to do that for us so that we could live in love for him. So that we could finally have what we can't have in any other relationship. Listen, absolute security. To be loved and feel so safe that you know you are never going to lose that love, right? Absolute security. A love that will never let you go. One of my favorite songs. So let's go back and read again from Colossians 3, because there's a lot packed into these verses. So, if you've been raised with Christ, verse 1, seek the things that are above, pursue where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. Verse 3, for you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Whoa, okay, so we're saying why should we do this? Why should we set our hearts and minds, our whole selves on Christ above everything else? Because you already died with him. You've already been raised with him. And right now, your life is already safely hidden together with Christ in God. Paul said it to the Ephesians this way. He said, for he raised us from the dead along with Christ and what? Seated us with him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. So right now, what does this say? Like Tony said, above, below, it's not geographical, okay? Right now, Christ is seated in the Trinity. Christ is one of the three who together are the living God, right? And guess what? You and I are also seated there in the Trinity right now. You and I are seated there, he says, hidden in Christ. Here's what that looks like. Here's an illustration from like decades ago. Rick will remember this. What does it mean? Tony's looking at me because he didn't know I was going to do this. I thought of it this morning.
She's like walking toward me here, so I'm suddenly very afraid.
With my fist. Right? No. Although I think I could take you. No. That's my fierceness talking. Okay. If this is you and me, this is you and me. We're hidden in Christ, right? And Christ is hidden, put your hands around mine, please, in God. All right, how secure is that? In me and you, in Christ, in God, and the hands are never removed for all eternity. Does it get more secure than that?
No.
Okay, that's what he's talking about, thank you. That's what he's talking about. Here.
That was easier than this.
That's how secure we are. So because that's true, Paul goes on and he says, because you've been raised to this kind of security in Christ spiritually, down in the core of our beings, You are now free to live your new heavenly life in this world. And how do you do this? Okay, by pursuing these things, but also by putting aside some earthly things. Let's pick it up in verse 5. He says, okay, because all this is true, put to death. Literally, what this word is in Greek is deaden. Deaden, therefore, whatever in you is earthly. Here's some examples. Fornication, impurity, passions. Now, that doesn't mean holy passions. We're going to get into that in a minute. Evil desires, greed, which is idolatry. These are the ways you also once followed when you were living that life, before you were hidden in Christ. But now that you're living a new life in Christ, you must get rid of, and this is a command in Greek, you must get rid of, literally what it says is you must put aside all such things. Such things as anger, wrath, malice, slander, abusive language from your mouth. And it's interesting because it looks like he considers lying to be abusive language. Do not lie to one another. Seeing what? That you've stripped off. Literally what this says is seeing that you've slipped out of your old self. That old self with its practices, you slipped right out of it. And you've clothed yourself, literally, you slipped out of the old self, that old person you used to be, and you've slipped into, you've clothed yourselves with a new self, which is being renewed in knowledge. And this word is more than, it's not knowing, reciting, memorizing scripture verses and that kind of knowing about God. It is that, but it's more than that. See, it's more than head knowledge. This is, you're being renewed in the deep, full knowing of Christ relationally in oneness. You're being renewed in this deep knowing according to the image of its creator. You're being recreated, transformed. Does it make sense? And in that transformation, in that renewing, back into the original image that you were created, we were created in the beginning to reflect, in that, there is no longer, get this, Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all and in all. It's all Christ. Now that's a lot, so let me simplify it and then give an example. So, as Tony was saying, we keep saying it, I'm thinking it's getting through. Your old self is already dead, and you have already been raised to new life in Christ spiritually. However, as Rick used to say decades ago, that new spiritual self in Christ, what, down in the core of your being, is still living in the same old earthly house. That the old deathly patterns that sin wired into your thoughts and your emotions, your desires and your appetites are still there in that old house. But good news again, you're now alive and free in Christ who now lives in that old house with you. I live in an old house. Man, I know what it's like to renew old houses. He lives here with us. Your new self in him is no longer captive to those old behaviors. Why? Because you now have his wiring. And you can choose that and live from that instead of the old wiring in your bodies. Are we together? So your risen self can now do what you couldn't do before. You can deaden sin's old wiring within you. All of a sudden, I got a picture of Jay Lead. I should have talked to him. He's an electrician. Like, how do you deaden? Like, in my house, if I wanted to change the wiring, why go through and pull it all out? Just deaden it. Take the power source out. That's what he's talking about. We deaden sin's old wiring by living according to Christ's new wiring in us. Paul, again, he told the Romans, and he put it this way, consider yourselves dead to sin's power. The switch is turned off. But living for God in the power Christ Jesus gives you. Flip, switch on. Here in Colossians, Paul's using the image of clothing to make the same point. In Christ, you've slipped out of your old dead self, those old garments, that old self, and it no longer has power over you. Listen, accept the power you give it. We are all free. No, none of us have to sin. None of us have to. We can be tempted. Temptation's not sin. But you've got to learn. We've got to learn to discern, when am I being tempted, and then pause instead of just going with it. Oh, there's the old wiring. I'm just going to go with it. Stop. Pause and say, oh, wait, I'm being tempted. Do I really want to do that? No, I really don't. And lean into the power of the new wiring. Do we make sense here? You give power. When you sin, devil's not making you do it. Nobody's making you do it. You're allowing yourself to simply go with the old flow. You're giving power to sin to rule over you. We don't have to do that anymore. We're new creations in Christ. We do not have to sin anymore. Now, will we? Yes. Will we be forgiven? Yes. But we've got to wake up to reality. We're responsible for this new life in Christ, to live it. See, your new self is alive inside, but the truth is, for all of us, it's like Lazarus, right? We're alive on the inside, but still wrapped in the old self's grave clothes. The good news, again, it's that you can take off these old clothes, fold them up and put them aside. That's what, in Colossians here, that's what the verb is that Paul is using. In Greek, literally, take off the clothes, fold them up, and put them aside. Why? Because those old behaviors are not you anymore. Those old clothes don't fit you anymore. Of course, now, this doesn't happen overnight, right? It's a process. It takes time to unwind and release those old patterns, like the strips of the grave cloths. And we can't do it alone. We need to actively participate with God's grace. We need each other's help. But over time, what we find is that we're being transformed from the inside out, more and more and more, living the life that's already in us. So it's important to recognize here that Paul is not simply making checklists of sins to avoid. That's how most people come to this passage. Look at those lists and look at those sins. Make a list and say, this is what we have to stop doing, right, in our own effort.
To do and to not do.
Right, this is not, see that shirt? This is not what it's about. This is not about becoming rigid or legalistic. This is not about being controlled by external shoulds. This is not about ranking certain sins as more sinful than others, which is usually just our way of judging others and letting ourselves off the hook. Nope. Paul is not telling us to manage sin in our lives. He's telling us to live free from sin in our lives. What does it look like practically? It looks like taking our power back in Christ. It looks like consciously choosing, as I said, not to go with the flow of our old patterns and trust the Spirit to empower us to live as new creations, as those who are, have been and are being restored to God's original design for us. So remember, when God created us, he created us, humans, with a full array of emotions, right? And physical appetites and desires. And he said that every part of us, including all, you know, all of our God-given, God-created selves, all of it is very good, including all of those emotions and appetites and desires. They start out good. But what happens? And I'm going to use the example of anger here. What happens is, think about it. So in and of itself, anger, it's not bad. It's not wrong. God has anger, right? Is God sinning? No. It's just that God is always angry in ways that are life-giving and holy. Our anger, on the other hand, gets distorted by our brokenness, by our sin. And yet still, the scriptures, and it's a command, be angry. Ephesians 4:26, be angry and do not sin. What is that? It's saying you can, we can feel anger without sinning as it was in the beginning. Why? Because putting aside anger doesn't mean denying it.
It doesn't mean avoiding it at all costs. Do you know repressed anger is just as damaging, can be just as damaging as wrongly expressed anger?
No, it isn't.
Right. And rightly expressed anger can be as deeply loving and it produce energy, right? It's about energy. It produces energy for holy action. So what do we need? What's he saying? Okay, what we need to do then is ask God to show us the difference. Do some discernment. Ask the Holy Spirit. Show me anger that's holy. Show me the new anger that is Christ's. And then show me how to live that out. In other words, show me, God, how to cooperate with your grace and with your healing so that over time I can put aside the anger that looks like selfish control and temper tantrums. And I can be free to experience anger as a spirit-energized expression of love. I know, that sounds really weird, doesn't it? But if you have ever loved someone enough that when you've seen them being hurt, there is something that rises up in you that is fierce, that wants to protect them, that's what we're talking about. Holy anger, holy emotions, the new wiring in Christ. Amen? Yeah. Did I say this doesn't happen overnight? This is the process.
I love that image that you just came up with spontaneously. This wasn't in the notes about the power source.
Yes.
Yes. And when we're tapped into the power source that is the sin nature, it's actually harder to do
exactly
Christ things. And it's easier because that's the power source we're hooked up to. It's easier to sin. But when that gets turned off and we're hooked up to Christ, it actually becomes harder to sin.
Yes.
Because we have to purposely choose to hook up kind of like an artificial power source to it.
Yep.
I got to replace a battery in my lawnmower today. You know, we have to hook something up in order to do that, because we're not going to get that kind of energy from Christ. It's not going to be the power to sin. So, it's a beautiful image.
Great, yeah. Thanks, God.
I'm going to put that in a message sometime. Let's change the metaphor on you and say, because Paul didn't know anything about batteries and electricity, but he did know about clothes. So let's stick with his metaphor a little bit there. Did any of you choose your clothes this morning out of the laundry hamper?
I have
and
done.
Would
that
you
before.
Tell us if you did?
I've done that before.
Yeah, I mean, we might put on something dirty and smelly to, say, do a dirty and smelly job, right? But for the most part, and you don't have to tell anybody, most part we put on clean clothes every day. And we buy new clothes when the old ones get torn or stained or too smelly, and when they don't fit us anymore, or when they just don't look like me anymore. Well, Paul's using that same kind of image. Mm-hmm. Just as we have put aside some things that are not helpful in a resurrected life, so we also put on some things that are. So that's his next verb. What we're doing here is actually just walking through and looking at a list of imperative verbs.
Yeah, they're all commands.
That Paul has here in Colossians 3. Do this, don't do this, this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So, well, what things should we be putting on? Well, we're going to see a parallel thing to what Joanne was just talking about here. Here's what he says to the Colossians. Having put aside those things, now, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, remember that, by the way, you're already holy and already beloved.
Yes.
You don't do this in order to become holy or become beloved. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Just rattle off those lists of really incredible things. Bear with one another. And if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you. So you must also forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Cool. In other words, don't be a naked Christian.
Yes.
Well, not quite. Let's think of it this way. Our new self in Christ, joined to Christ in spirit, is spirit. It's invisible. So how can anyone outside of us tell what's happened inside of us? It's by how we live. That becomes our clothing, our behavior, our relationships, our words. These reveal on the outside what is already true to us on the inside. Mm-hmm. And as the Spirit of Christ does his work in us, we're becoming more and more transformed over time into the image of Christ. So over time, we start looking more and more like him. We put on Christ's mind, we love of Christ's heart, we speak of Christ's words, and so on. We clothe ourselves with Christ. He's the best fashion designer in the world. Got the best stuff to wear. And then Paul gives us some examples of what this looks like. Compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, patience, forgiveness, and love. And his point, just like in the previous list, is not to make checklists of duties to perform. Paul is simply giving a few examples of the kind of things that we will inevitably choose to wear spiritually because they're the kind of things that Christ does, because that's who Christ is. And if Christ is in us, wouldn't it make sense? This is not scrunching up your face and saying, oh, okay, now I really got to work it, whatever. Ben Franklin did that, by the way. This wasn't in the notes either. He made a list of 31 virtues he wanted to inhabit, and he assigned one to each day of the month. And every day of the month, he would work real hard to try to become more like that. But Ben Franklin also told a story about how he walked away from Christ.
Yeah.
So for him, it was a self-improvement plan. For us, it's Christ improvement. He has already done it for us, and then what we do get to do is live it out.
Yeah.
So, in another letter, he gives a similar list. I was just thinking about this. Calls these character qualities the fruit of the Spirit.
Yep.
Every time we talk about the fruit of the Spirit, Joanne does her thing about how the fruit tree is not out there scrunching up its face and grunting and groaning, trying to make apples pop out.
They like that in Bulgaria. Do you remember?
Yes, that's true. There's that fist thing again. What's the fist thing with it?
It's fruit.
No. So in Galatians, he's talking about fruit trees, but it's getting at the same thing. He's saying, like Jesus said, if Jesus is the trunk, the vine, and the tree, and we're the branches, then the kind of fruit we're going to produce will look and taste like Christ. It will just be like that as we allow Christ to work out his life in us. We don't have to make it happen.
Yes.
But we do get to choose whether we will participate with Christ. So these lists of things to put on or bear fruit, they're helpful red flags to us. If what people see in us, if what they experience of us, doesn't look and feel and sound and taste more like Christ over time, then it's possible that we're still hanging on to the remnants of the old dead self somehow, that we're still dressing up in our old clothes.
Yeah.
And we're looking a little dirty and stinky as a result. Definitely. On the other hand, this can also be a happy flag, right? As people see more and more compassion and kindness and humility and meekness, patience, forgiveness, and love, and other qualities to that, if they start seeing that stuff in us, that tells us we're becoming more and more to life spiritually.
Yeah.
We're living more like the resurrection that is already true of us. And if you think about it, isn't that the kind of person you want to be? I find very few people that say, you know, I really want to be a mean, nasty, despicable, hate-filled, angry person. Who wants to do that? We want to be like this. And daggone it, doesn't the world need us to be like that, especially now?
Yes.
My goodness. We're even surprised sometimes when it happens. We're in a world that is so angry and polarized. Let me give you an illustration. I had a happy one this week.
Yep.
A young man had applied to the seminary that Joanne and I both work at. He really wanted to come. But then he read our documents, found a position we hold that he didn't agree with. And he wrote me the other day this sad email message saying that he wouldn't be coming. And I wrote back and said, I was really very sorry to hear that. I kind of liked the guy. I never met him, but I liked the way he talked. And I assured him, however, that we don't require everyone to agree with us on everything. Do you? Mm-hmm. See, this was part of... Anyway, I'll get to that. I said if he wanted, he could still study with us, even while thinking and even living it out a little differently than we do, as long as he could honor the rest of us. And I warned him that his fellow students and instructors, for the most part, would think he was wrong on that particular position, that issue. They might even say so. Well, for many people these days, those are fighting words.
Yeah.
So his response to me was not at all what I expected. I want to read it to you. Mm. He says, this context, he thanked me, and said, this context is exceedingly helpful. And even more importantly, I felt the Holy Spirit speak through your words.
Yes.
That made me happy.
Yes.
I was under the false impression I would not be permitted to study at your seminary. Because the assumption was, unless you agree with everybody down the line, you're not welcome. I am overjoyed to hear that this is still a possibility. Also, I understand completely that the majority of those at the seminary would see this issue differently, as have many, many of my most beloved friends and family. I would strive to approach them as I approach all that I disagree with on any issue, namely in love, humility, and grace,
yes,
with my identity firmly rooted in Christ. I look forward to moving forward with my application. Yeah. Thank you for applauding him. You heard the humility and love and grace in that, didn't you? You heard the Spirit of Christ. I did. Now, I didn't tell you what position of ours he was struggling with, because that doesn't matter for the illustration.
There are several to choose from.
Oh, yeah. We all have stuff that we feel strongly about.
Yep.
In fact,
there's stuff I don't agree with, but I can still teach there.
Yeah. Yes. Maybe it would be good for you to think of an issue that's very dear to you. Mm. One that might make it hard for you to be in the same room with people who disagree with you. Or at least to be able to respond to them with humility and grace.
Yes.
Is there some hot button issue in your life? This might be exactly where Christ is inviting you to wear his clothes a bit more.
Yep.
And show others the new life that he's given you.
Wow. I just wanted to stop for a minute. Because do you feel the Spirit? No. That exchange, we've got to learn how to speak to one another like that. We just have to do it. All right, well, let's start to pull these things together. Okay, so Paul says, since you've been raised with Christ, you can stay fully alive if you pursue these things, put aside these things, put on these things, and then finally, the fourth thing he talks about, he says, is permit these things. They're all P's, thanks to Tony. He does like them to be all P's. So, in verses 15 and 16, Paul says, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. So now he's moving from our individual bodies and what's happening in here to the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. And with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. So Paul closes this call, you know, these 17 verses, this call to stay alive in Christ with a final series of commands. See, all of those are still commands. So far, up to this point, Paul's been instructing us about how to actively cooperate with Christ in the power of his resurrection, so that that resurrection outworks into every aspect of our lives and our relationships. But in the final two verses of this section, what we just read, Paul describes shared life. The shared life that our individual choices will produce in our faith community. And he's saying, let it. It's a command, but it's not something we can make happen. It's not something we can create, this shared life. See, this is what happens through us and among us as we continue individually to allow Christ's life than to become the shared life that we're living together. So what he's basically saying, he's saying, you know, your hearts will be literally umpired. It doesn't say ruled. It's not like dominating, ruled like that. Your hearts will be umpired by the peace of God. In other words, there's going to be disagreements. We just had an example of one that works out in the body of Christ in a very holy way.
But there, he's saying, there'll be disagreements, there's going to be misunderstandings, of course. But you must permit the peace of God that's present in each individual heart, that one same peace, spirit, to be the umpire in any disagreement, misunderstanding. And listen, no matter how serious the issue, what he's saying is, no one should walk off the field. We don't get the final call because this call has already been made, and the umpire, the spirit within us, will help us to find a way to live in peace together even if we disagree with one another. In other words, what he's saying is put on that clothing of love and peace, and let the fruit of the spirit be present in your life because you've been called to live in peace as the one body of Christ. And then as we do that, the next thing he says is, then become thankful ones. Gratitude rises when we're able to live like that. And then he goes on, he says, and then the word of Christ. And remember, this wasn't a Bible with gold leaf pages at this point, right? He's writing, Paul's writing this. He's talking about the living word, Christ himself. Let the word, which includes his teaching, but his being, then the word is going to come alive in you and dwell abundantly within you, and you'll have God's wisdom to share with each other. In rich teachings, gentle cautions, because we do need to caution one another, and singing psalms and hymns and songs, which flow back to God with grace, and I love this, from your, it doesn't say hearts. As this is happening, what is happening? Our hearts individually become one heart.